Professor of Radiology and Surgery, and he is from our Division of Vascular and Interventional Radiology. His topic today is management of gastrointestinal hemorrhage. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Georgiadis.
Good morning or good afternoon for those of you joining us from other continents, and thank you for attending today's lecture. I'll spend the next approximately 40 to 45 minutes discussing these minimally invasive techniques in treating gastrointestinal hemorrhage. At the end, we will have some questions and answers to conclude. This is a somewhat technical lecture because of the nature of interventional radiology, and I will attempt to keep those technical issues to a minimum and concentrate on clinical, the clinical part of the treatment of GI bleeding. However, some technical discussion is necessary. As recently as 10 to 15 years ago, the treatment of gastrointestinal hemorrhage was either expectant, meaning transfusing the patient as needed, correcting a coagulopathy if the patient had a coagulopathy, and hoping that the hemorrhage would stop. Eventually, of course, it did stop. Or if that was not successful, surgical intervention was necessary, and surgery was a major event for these people who are usually older, and it involved either hemicolectomy or total colectomy, partial gastrectomy or total gastrectomy with the associated comorbidities. The invention of minimally invasive techniques by interventional radiology has indeed made endovascular techniques the mainstay of treatment for gastrointestinal hemorrhage. The objective of interventions to arrest GI hemorrhage is to do so effectively, and to do so one must have experience. The appropriate supplies, we are utilizing multiple catheters, embolization techniques, which require a lot of experience to be successful. In addition, and probably most importantly, one has to have a plan before attempting to stop a GI bleeding. We must do so safely, meaning the patient must be prepared appropriately. The patient obviously needs to have adequate blood transfusion, vital stabilization, team support, and again, a plan in place. The procedure must be performed promptly, and this is an important issue. Promptly does not mean as soon as possible. The nature of GI bleeding is that it is not continuous. GI bleeding occurs for a few minutes, stops for a few minutes, starts again, patients bleed for an hour, and then they stop for a couple of hours. So promptly means when the patient is actively bleeding, not immediately. Upper and lower GI bleeding have different complications and treatment options, and we must distinguish between the two. As you know, the difference between upper and lower GI regions is defined by the vascular watershed zone between the celiac artery and the superior mesenteric artery, which is at the third portion of the duodenum. The most common causes of upper GI bleeding, which you can see on your left side, is duodenal and gastric ulcer, erosive gastritis, followed by esophageal varices. It's important to note that varices cannot be treated in an endovascular arterial approach. They're usually related to portal hypertension, and a TIPS is required. Angiodysplasia, even though most commonly seen in the colon, can indeed be seen in the small bowel as well. Esophagitis, Mallory Weiss tear, and about 10% of upper GI bleeding goes undiagnosed. Most common causes of lower GI bleeding is diverticulitis, angiodysplasia, and cancer, and the relative risk of those depends mostly on the patient's age. Inflammatory bowel disease and surgery in hospitals are also important causes of GI bleeding. There are multiple embolization methods that one can use to stop bleeding, and they are termed either permanent or temporary. In reality, none of them is absolutely permanent and none of them is absolutely temporary. The most permanent method of embolization are coils, which you can see on your left side under the word permanent, and these are metallic coils, usually with fibers attached to them to promote clotting. And I say nothing is permanent because if a patient has an abnormal coagulation profile, example would be an INR of 3 or 4, these coils are not going to cause thrombosis and the patient will continue bleeding. So again, we use the terms permanent versus temporary in a relative fashion. Particles are also considered somewhat permanent in the nature, as is glue, though I have seen glue dissolve after a few days. Gel foam, autologous blood clot are considered temporary embolization methods and usually last for a few days to a few weeks. For most patients, this embolization method is adequate as the injury by then heals and no further bleeding occurs. Vasopressin, in our institution at least and many other institutions, is no longer used because it is the most temporary method of arresting GI bleeding and is associated with significant cardiovascular toxicity. And finally, the advent of flexible, small, covered stents avails itself to arresting GI bleeding without embolizing a vessel. If a vessel is of reasonable size, 3 to 4 millimeters or larger, one can deploy a stent graft across the site of injury in the wall of that vessel, isolating the bleed and allowing the vessel to remain open. And that is an excellent option only, however, for vessels that have a certain size or are larger. Before intervention, one must understand certain important issues about the nature of the disease and the patient. All GI bleeding is intermittent. Like we said before, bleeding starts and stops at random intervals. It is therefore important for the angiography to be performed when the patient is actively bleeding. If the patient is not bleeding, the diagnostic portion will be negative and we will not be able to embolize the site of injury. Another important issue is that thinned blood does not clot. It is very important to correct as much as possible any coagulopathy before attempting to embolize. INR must ideally be less than 1.8, platelets must be above 50, and the APTT ratio must be normal as well. One should transfuse platelets and FFP as needed to correct those values. Communication and expectations are also important. One must discuss the plan and the expectations with both the referring team and the family of the patient. Even though these minimally invasive techniques are successful in about 70 to 80% of the patients, about 20% of the patients they are not successful and major morbidity or even mortality may ensue. During the intervention, the patients must be treated as an imminent code. These patients are actively bleeding and one must be ready to administer blood products, blood, be ready for a full code, and ensure that the patient has a protected airway and the vitals are at least monitored. An arterial line is not absolutely necessary, but may become necessary in case there is a code. Also, make sure that during the time of intervention, enough members of the team are available to run the code if one is called. Treatment of the patient with GI bleeding does not stop with the embolization. It is important to monitor the patient after embolization. Some patients will continue to bleed or re-bleed from other sites that have not been identified originally. Re-embolization may become necessary. Access site precautions, usually the groin, are required to prevent a focal hematoma, as well as renal support. Usually these patients are treated with large amounts of contrast, and good hydration is necessary to prevent renal failure. One important point after embolization is that the success of embolization is determined not by the first hematocrit after embolization, as that will be lower than before embolization. Remember, the patient continues to bleed during the procedure. Rather, on how the patient responds to transfusion. And again, one final point, if the patient re-bleeds, re-intervention is indicated, as most patients will be successfully embolized, if not the first, at least the second time. Now we'll proceed through individual cases of gastrointestinal bleeding in a methodical way from head to toe, so to speak. We'll start with our first case. These are all real cases that we've encountered recently at Johns Hopkins and were treated successfully. This is a patient who was in the hospital chronically with an unrelated disease and suddenly developed a massive upper GI hemorrhage. One would not think to look at the esophagus first, but indeed what we've noticed here, and you will see there's an NG tube running right next to the aorta. And on the image on your right side, the five planes between the aorta and the NG tube, nasogastric tube, are lost. That raised the suspicion to the interventional radiologist enough to perform a thoracic arteriogram, which we usually do not perform in cases of GI bleeding. And you can see on this image, there's a focal area of extravasation halfway up the aorta, right next to the NG tube. This is quite concerning. Obviously, this is a direct aortal esophageal fistula. These injuries are usually not survivable. However, this patient happened to be in the right place at the right moment. Embolization of the aorta is not an option here, but what is an option, remember we discussed, is the use of covered stents. We measured the diameter of the aorta and deployed the appropriate stent graft here, indicated by the two arrows, and stopped the bleeding. Moving on to our second case, a case that very often discussed, but not as often seen, and mostly isolated to patients who are chronically ill in the hospital or patients who are alcoholic, a Mallory Weiss tear. On the image on your left, you can see a celiac arteriogram indicated by the green arrow, and the branches of the celiac artery, the splenic artery to your right, the hepatic to your left, and the smaller left gastric traveling upwards towards the red circle. The red circle shows the hemorrhage, which is at the GE junction. You can note the nasogastric tube traveling through the E junction right next to the hemorrhage. On the image to your right, you can see a selective arteriogram through a catheter that has been used to select the left gastric artery. That shows the hemorrhage to better advantage at the GE junction, again indicated by the red circle. One has to keep in mind that the upper GI system, the vascular supply of it, is more forgiving. There are more collaterals, and one does not need to be as distal and as selective in embolizing. Therefore, in embolizing upper GI bleeding, one can embolize the main vessel, the left gastric, the gastroepiploics, etc., unlike the lower GI system, which we'll talk about later. So, from this approach, we indeed embolized the main left gastric artery, the hemorrhage promptly stopped, and the patient did fine. You will note that in most of these cases we use coils, which is the most commonly used embolization method. Case number three, that of erosive gastritis, again a disease mostly seen in hospitalized patients due to prolonged stress. This is a challenging cause of GI bleeding to treat because there is usually no focal extravasation. Instead, what one sees, as indicated by the green arrows here, is a diffuse, slow oozing from the surface of a large area of the stomach, in this case, the gastric fundus. This is another such case of erosive gastritis. This was a patient we treated last week, post-pancreatectomy, with a massive acute upper GI bleed and hypotension. The axial image of the CAT scan seen on your left shows thickened gastric rugae, indicated by the red arrow, which raised the suspicion of erosive gastritis. The image on your right faintly suggests a hypervascular region in the left lateral wall of the stomach, indicated by the yellow arrows. This is a celiac arteriogram performed through a selective catheter. A more selective arteriogram was performed using a microcatheter, which shows here, again with yellow arrows, how hypervascular the lateral wall of the stomach is compared to the rest of the stomach. This signifies erosive gastritis. And what the endoscopist will see is a large inflamed area, thickened area of the wall of the stomach that oozes blood diffusely. Note that this is a splenic arteriogram and not a gastric arteriogram. And remember from anatomy that the stomach indeed receives blood supply from multiple short gastric arteries originating from the splenic artery. So one has to keep in mind that those can be the source of bleeding as well. After embolizing the splenic artery with coils, as seen on the image on your right, the coils are indicated by the green arrow, the bleeding stopped immediately. The patient did fine. Case number 5, a classic case of gastric ulcer. This is a somewhat complicated slide, and I'll explain it. The patient is post-liver transplant, and as you know, patients who receive liver transplant have their GDA, the gastroduodenal artery, ligated, and that is indicated by the red arrow. The gastroduodenal artery is supplied classically by the celiac axis, but once it's ligated, collateral supply from the superior mesenteric artery takes over and supplies the GDA. The yellow arrows follow the distal part of the GDA, which becomes the gastroepiploic, and you can see the gastroepiploic, again the yellow arrows, sweeping around to the left side of the patient towards the staples. The staples were placed the previous day by endoscopy in an attempt to stop the gastric hemorrhage unsuccessfully. We inserted a microcatheter, which were able to negotiate all the way distal into the gastroepiploic artery and deploy coils to stop the blood supply to the gastric ulcer. One important point about GI bleeding is that one must perform a complete arteriogram, not simply stop when one point of hemorrhage is noted. And this case illustrates that point nicely. After embolizing the gastroepiploic artery, we performed the celiac axis arteriogram, which again showed continued hemorrhage in the same location, but this time being supplied by the left gastric artery. The left gastric artery is indicated by the yellow arrows and the hemorrhage right in the region of the clips placed by endoscopy the previous day is indicated by the red circle. Again, using a smaller catheter, we obtained a more selective axis. The image on your left shows the bleeding ulcer, indicated by the red circle. And you can see nicely delineated the vascular supply of the fundus of the stomach by the left gastric artery. After coil embolization, coils shown by the yellow arrow on the image on your right, the bleeding stopped and no longer one sees extravasation in the region of the clips. Again, this patient did fine after this embolization as all bleeding stopped. Case number 6, a gastric pseudoaneurysm. The image on your left is an abdominal aortogram, and immediately one notices a round area of hyperdensity in the left upper quadrant, indicated by the red arrow. A selective left gastric arteriogram notes a pseudoaneurysm approximately 1 centimeter in size, PSA pseudoaneurysm, in the region of the stomach. This is not the same as an ulcer. The main difference is that in treating a pseudoaneurysm, a direct injury to the blood vessel, one must ensure that the vessel is embolized both distal and proximal to the pseudoaneurysm. Remember, there is ample collateral blood supply in the upper GI system. Therefore, embolizing only one side of the pseudoaneurysm will result in continuous bleeding as that side of injury is supplied by the other side. Using a microcatheter, we crossed distal to the side of injury and embolized both distally and proximally, thereby stopping the bleeding. Case number 7 is a case of Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, one that we talk about in medical school often but rarely seen. This is a patient who has a biliary tube for cholangiocarcinoma, which is unrelated to this case. And a celiac arteriogram was performed to locate the site of upper GI bleeding, which was promptly identified as a duodenal ulcer in the second portion of the duodenum. One also notes a hypervascular mass in the head of the pancreas, which was a known gastrinoma. using a microcatheter again. In this magnified view, we entered the small branch supplying the duodenal bleed and embolized with two or three small coils, stopping the bleeding. Case number 8 is another case of duodenal ulcer. This is a classic isolated sporadic duodenal ulcer. The abdominal aortogram on your left shows all the three mesenteric vessels that one has to interrogate to ensure a complete diagnostic workup of the GI system: the celiac axis, the superior mesenteric artery, and the inferior mesenteric artery. We usually start with the inferior mesenteric artery, irrespective of where we suspect the GI bleeding source to be. The reason is the patient's bladder fills with contrast rather quickly and may obscure GI bleeding from a lower colonic source. So we interrogate that part of the bowel first to ensure adequate diagnosis. Then we proceed to the superior mesenteric artery and finally the celiac axis. In this case, the inferior mesenteric and superior mesenteric arteriograms were negative. However, a selective celiac arteriogram seen on your right shows a faint focal region of contrast extravasation indicated by the red arrow and supplied by a branch of the pancreatico-duodenal artery. The pancreatico-duodenal artery is a branch of the GDA indicated by yellow arrow. Now, this extravasation may sound small and insignificant. However, one has to keep in mind that this image was generated within 1 or 2 seconds, and we're already seeing half a cc of blood loss. If one multiplies that over a few hours, one can easily appreciate how serious this could be for the patient, who can lose their entire volume of blood within a few hours. Even though the blood supply to the upper GI system is very collateralized, and one can perform embolization from a proximal location, it is a good idea to embolize as distal as possible to allow for re-embolization if one becomes necessary. In this case, we utilized a microcatheter and entered the gastroduodenal artery, as seen on your left. Again, the hemorrhage is noted by the red circle, and then entered the pancreatico-duodenal artery using a microcatheter, which was embolized, as indicated by the yellow arrow on your right. Case number 9, now we're moving on to a lower GI bleed. One main distinction between upper and lower GI bleed is the difference in collateral supply. Again, remember that the stomach and duodenum receive blood supply from multiple sources: the left gastric, the right gastric, the left and right gastroepiploic, the gastroduodenal, as well as multiple short gastric arteries from the splenic artery. So embolizing one or two or even three sometimes, if necessary, of these large vessels is usually inconsequential. On the other hand, blood supply to the lower GI system has much less collateralization. What that means is that one cannot perform embolization of a main branch of the lower GI bleed, of a patient with lower GI bleeding, because of the risk of colonic ischemia. Therefore, it is critical in lower GI bleeding cases to be as selective as possible, and certainly beyond the right, middle, or left colic branches. This is an illustrative case of an elderly male who presented with life-threatening intermittent lower GI bleed. Actually, I remember this case very well, and nearly the entire blood supply of Johns Hopkins was exhausted trying to maintain these patients. He received 60 units of blood over 3 days. He was not a surgical candidate, and his coagulation profile was normal. The patient had an upper and lower GI endoscopy, which was non-diagnostic because of the amount of blood. A nuclear medicine scan was, however, suggestive of a right colonic source. The celiac axis arteriogram and the inferior mesenteric arteriogram were both negative, and what you see here is the superior mesenteric arteriogram, which at face value is normal. And usually we don't perform selective or further selective arteriograms unless we have a source that we suspect. In this case, we suspected the right colonic bleed, and we knew that the patient's only chance for survival was embolization. Therefore, we decided to select multiple branches of the superior mesenteric artery to investigate further. This is a magnified view of the selective arteriogram via a microcatheter of the right colic artery. And you can see, let me go back one. Right here you can see the extravasation in the upper part of the right colic branch. Well, remember what we said about the lower GI system. You cannot embolize the main branches here, and we certainly cannot embolize the right colic branch. If we do, the right colon will become ischemic, necrotic, and the patient will require a colectomy. And remember, the patient is not a surgical candidate. That's why we decided to go above and beyond the usual diagnostic arteriogram. So it behooves us at this point to find the branch that is actually bleeding. You can see there are multiple, probably dozen tiny branches, that each of which can be the source. We proceeded over 2 hours to select each one of these tiny branches, and eventually, as you can see on the right lower image, we identified the one that was causing the bleeding and embolized it with three or four microcoils, and thereby stopping the lower GI bleeding. And again, this case illustrates that in the lower GI bleeding patients, embolization must be performed as distally and as selectively as possible, unlike cases of upper GI bleeding. Angiodysplasia is one of the most common causes of lower GI bleeding, especially in the elderly population. Angiodysplasia is a tiny arteriovenous fistula, usually seen in the cecum, but can be seen anywhere in the lower GI system, can also be seen in the upper GI system more rarely. This tiny AV fistula causes erosion of the mucosa and low-grade continuous hemorrhage. This is another case of angiodysplasia on your left, and the hemorrhage is indicated in both cases by the red circle. Conventional wisdom until about 10 years ago was that angiodysplasia, as many of the causes of lower GI bleeding, could only be treated surgically. However, the advent of microcatheters, better wires, better techniques, and smaller coils allow us to obtain access very distally into the very tiny distal branches of the vessel that is bleeding and embolize it without sacrificing the blood supply to the normal bowel and risking ischemia. This is a case of diverticulitis, another common cause of lower GI bleeding, probably the most common cause of lower GI bleeding. This is an inferior mesenteric artery arteriogram, and what is supplied here by this vessel is the descending colon and the sigmoid colon. You can see, highlighted in the red circle, focal extravasation in the mid portion of the descending colon, a very, very distal branch of the IMA. Again, conventional wisdom would have this patient go to the operating room and be treated with partial left hemicolectomy with the associated comorbidities. You can see how difficult it would be to negotiate the large catheters that we had 10 years ago into those very small, tortuous distal vessels. However, the advent of microcatheters, as seen here in this very magnified view, allows us to get access very distally into the vasa recta. This is a magnified view, and all you see here is colon. The red arrow on your left shows the tip of the microcatheter, which is already in the mucosa of the descending colon, and the red circle signifies the active hemorrhage inside the lumen of the descending colon. Since no other part of the colon is supplied by that vessel, it is safe to embolize without compromising vascular supply to normal colon. Again, in a magnified view, you can see the two coils that we deployed to arrest the hemorrhage indicated by the red arrow. Many causes of GI bleeding are post-surgical in nature. There are obviously many types of surgery that can be complicated by GI bleeding. However, they all have one common important point that we need to know before attempting embolization, and that is altered vascular supply or vascular anatomy. And that is true in both the upper and lower GI system. Before attempting embolization in a patient who had abdominal surgery, it is important for the interventionalist to understand and know how the vascular anatomy was altered. Remember we said the upper GI system is very forgiving in proximal embolization. Well, that would not be the case if, for example, a surgeon previously has ligated some of those collateral supply vessels. So it is important to know the vascular anatomy and understand what one can or cannot embolize safely. This is a patient with lower GI bleeding after a Billroth II anastomosis. This is a superior mesenteric arteriogram, and you can see the stay sutures in the middle of the abdomen immediately after surgery. And in the left lower quadrant of the patient, on your right lower, you can see focal extravasation in the early arterial phase. As we wait a few seconds to look at the venous phase, one can see the linear contrast markings in that region, which are accumulated within the folds of the small bowel. That is a focal anastomotic hemorrhage, and one has to be very careful in embolizing these cases. The bowel has an end-to-end anastomosis, and blood supply is compromised from either direction. If therefore one embolizes the blood supply to the anastomosis, it is possible, there is a high risk, that there will be ischemia to the anastomosis and anastomotic breakdown. It doesn't mean that one does not embolize under any circumstances. If this is a life-threatening hemorrhage, one will embolize in communication with the surgeon who will, if need be in the future, repair a broken down anastomosis. But again, the point here is one has to be aware of any altered vascular anatomy in the GI system, upper or lower. In conclusion, there are many other causes of GI bleeding which are actually not coming from the stomach or the small bowel. For example, hemophilia, especially in our center, is a significant source of GI bleeding. Patients who have cholangiocarcinoma or other inflammatory infectious causes of biliary disease or have an instrumented common bile duct may have or present with hemophilia. And one has to keep in mind that that can be the source if upper and lower GI endoscopy are negative, and interrogate the blood vessels leading to the liver to ensure that proper treatment is offered to the patient. Direct arterial bowel fistula is also a possibility, especially in trauma or chronic inflammatory infectious diseases. We have seen a few patients with direct celiac or SMA artery to small bowel or gastric fistulas. Even a couple of cases of direct aortic to small bowel fistula. Again, these injuries are usually not survivable because of the large injury to the vessel, but if this occurs in the hospital and the patient makes it to the operating room in time, they may survive it, especially with the advent of the covered endostents that we have now that can cover the site of injury. Ischemic causes of hemorrhage are also noted, though extremely rare. Certain diseases cause bowel ischemia, as severe atherosclerotic does, and certain other causes like segmental mediolysis. One has to keep in mind that the cause of the hemorrhage is not injury to a blood vessel, but the necrosis of the bowel wall and the sloughing of the necrotic tissue, and further embolization may actually aggravate the situation and not stop the hemorrhage. So if one suspects or diagnoses hemorrhage from an ischemic source, the most proper treatment option is surgery. Venous hemorrhage constitutes about 10 to 15% of GI hemorrhage. And most of these patients have portal hypertension related to cirrhosis. And remember, the endovascular techniques that we described here today are all arterial techniques and will not diagnose nor can treat venous hemorrhage. The treatment of portal hypertension related variceal hemorrhage is a transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic shunt. Those varices can be diagnosed if one carries the arterial phase to the venous phase to indicate the dilated gastric or esophageal varices and then plan for appropriate treatment. We're done with the questions. So in the next few minutes, I will present five multiple choice questions. You will we'll go through one at a time. You'll have some time to answer those questions, and then we'll discuss them. And we'll proceed with the first question. Before attempting embolization, the bleeding must be controlled. And this is a true or false question. I have about 20 seconds to answer this question. It is false. Remember, the only chance an interventional radiologist has of seeing the bleeding is if the patient is actually bleeding. And that goes to the one of the first points that I made, that one must perform the attempt at embolization when the patient is actively bleeding. If the patient stops bleeding and everything is stable, it is almost always useless to send the patient for an arteriogram, as it will be negative. So make sure that you observe the patient closely, continuously, and with the first sign of active bleeding, which will usually be a bowel movement with bright red blood and an acute change in vitals, send the patient for an arteriogram as soon as possible. Let's move on to the second question. Endoscopy, upper endoscopy, shows fundal hemorrhage in the stomach. An arteriogram, however, does not show any hemorrhage. The next step is, choice one, embolize the left gastric artery. Choice number two, stop the procedure and re-angio when the patient bleeds again. Choice number three, refer the patient for surgery. And choice number four, refer the patient for repeat endoscopy. And again, we'll give you about 20 seconds to answer this question. See the answers to this question. So the correct answer here is to embolize the left gastric artery, and that goes to the second major point that we made in the lecture, that to the very good collateral vascular supply of the upper GI system, that one doesn't have to be very selective to embolize and stop the bleeding. If endoscopy showed fundal hemorrhage and the fundus of the stomach is supplied by the left gastric artery, embolizing the left gastric artery will stop the bleeding even if one does not see the bleeding at the time. The patient, again, may be bleeding or not bleeding at the time of the arteriogram, but they will certainly re-bleed again soon if they're not treated. So in the upper GI system, one can proceed with embolization without necessarily seeing active extravasation on the arteriogram, provided that we know accurately where the bleeding source is. Similarly, if upper endoscopy showed a duodenal bleed, a duodenal ulcer, but the arteriogram is negative, one can embolize the gastroduodenal artery without seeing active extravasation during the diagnostic portion of the arteriogram, and that again will stop the bleeding. This, however, is not an option in the lower GI system, where selective or super-selective embolization is necessary to prevent ischemia to the colon. Let's move on to the third question. A tacked red cell scan indicates descending colonic hemorrhage. No extravasation is seen on angio. The next step is to A. embolize the left colic artery, B. refer the patient for surgery, C. refer patient for endoscopy, D. repeat angiogram when the patient re-bleeds. And again, we'll wait 20 to 30 seconds to review the answers. Okay, let's look at the results. Very good. Looks like I answered this question during my previous answer. And that again goes to the differences between the upper and lower GI system. The lower GI system, one must be as selective as possible during the time of embolization to avoid ischemia to the colon. Remember, what we're trying to avoid here is surgery, and surgery has major comorbidities in this patient population because it is, at the very minimum, a hemicolectomy. Therefore, if one does not see the offending vessel, one should not embolize empirically in the lower GI system. Let's move on to the fourth question. Right after successful embolization, repeat hematocrit is lower than prior to angio. This is an indication for A. repeat angio, B. refer patient for surgery, C. repeat hematocrit, D. refer patient for endoscopy. Okay, let's look at the results of the voting. Very good. The correct answer is repeat hematocrit. And that makes the point of continuous hemorrhage during the procedure. Now remember, these patients have had their last hematocrit check a few hours before intervention, and the patient continued to bleed intermittently, but nevertheless continued to bleed from that point on until the embolization procedure and through the procedure. These patients usually have another hematocrit obtained immediately after embolization, and certainly that hematocrit will be lower than the previous one if the patient has not had a blood transfusion. The knee-jerk reaction is that the patient continues to bleed, which is not necessarily the case. The best indication of a successful embolization is appropriate pump of the hematocrit after transfusion. One can also repeat a hematocrit, a second one, after the procedure, which, if the embolization was successful, will be stable. move on to our fifth and final question. I have six. Not final. Fifth question. A patient with history of lower GI bleed becomes hypotensive, tachycardic, and passes large amounts of bright red blood per rectum. After stabilization, the next step is to perform a tagged red cell scan, refer patient for endoscopy, perform angio, or refer the patient for surgery. Okay, let's look at the results of the voting. Okay. Well, it seems like you agree with me, though I have to tell you this is a contentious question. Many people would recommend sending the patient for tagged red cell scan. I don't share that view, and many of my colleagues do not, and that again makes one of the major points of intervening in patients who are bleeding, and that is GI bleeding is intermittent. The red cell scan can take many, many hours, and certainly by then the bleeding would have stopped, maybe would have started again. But by sending the patient for a prolonged diagnostics test, we're missing the window of opportunity to intervene and stop the hemorrhage. So most of my colleagues and myself included would proceed with an arteriogram and embolization. Certainly, those of you who said A or even B are not incorrect. Some centers would perform endoscopy first, although I have to tell you that in most cases, lower GI endoscopy is not useful because of the amount of red blood cell, of red blood in the colon. This is not the case in the upper GI system, where endoscopy can indeed be very helpful. Remember the first question, where endoscopy can isolate the site of extravasation, and then we can embolize empirically without seeing extravasation. Moving on to the sixth question. The most common cause of GI bleed in the hospitalized patient is A, angiodysplasia, B, gastroesophageal varices, C, gastritis, gastric ulcer, and D, diverticulitis. Okay, let's see the results of the voting. Very good. This was somewhat of a trick question. Keep in mind that answers A, B, and D, angiodysplasia, gastroesophageal varices, and diverticulitis, usually occur with the patient outside the hospital. The stress and medications of the patient who has a prolonged hospital course usually are related to gastritis and gastric ulcer and associated hemorrhage. Our lecture will resume in 2 minutes.